Did you know that the kangaroo's pouch provides to the kangaroo's baby a safe environment from the outside world? This is exactly the purpose of the Shadow DOM encapsulate the application from the other page. Nice to meet you all. My name is Noah Wittenstein. I'm a front-end developer at the experience team at Minute Media. In my free time, I like to bake, travel, and paddle on a surfboard. My team specializes in standalone products that are React-based. Our main product is a video player. We provide a website hosted by another party, an end-to-end video platform within injectable video player in those hosted websites. Since we don't have any control over those websites, we encountered many problems in the player's implementation process. We can see here in this example, our video player is injected and looks as it should be into one of the websites. Suddenly, we noticed on that website, if we will take a closer look, that the player controls are not in place. Its size is not as it's supposed to be. The player's title is gone and a lot of black spaces. So the player CSS is broken for some reason, but why? We found out in the hosted website, suddenly the following style tag appears. It is a CSS selector that targets all the div elements in the DOM and applies a margin bottom with 40 pixels to each div element. This style tag is within the HTML document and thus the DOM, so it affects the whole page as well as our player. And as a result, the design of the player looks terrible. So what can we do? Therefore, we needed a solution for encapsulating our code. We want the player's markup structure, style, and behavior to be isolated from the rest of the page. We want to allow CSS scoping. It means that the style rules apply only to the player and page styles won't affect it. How about iframe? What is an iframe? iframe is an HTML document embedded inside another HTML document on a website. How an iframe solves our problem? The player is not affected by the code of the hosted website and it's shielded from the rest of the page's code so that we don't have to worry about the behavior problems or styling leaks. Now, the CSS of the player will be safe and the player's code will be encapsulated. It sounds good, so why not use an iframe? First, accessing element in an iframe from the parent document is complicated by design. The DOM elements are in a completely separate context, so you need to cross the iframe's DOM to access the values you need. Secondly, imagine creating a page using a set of 6 iframes that each contains one component. The resulting markup would be filled with iframe tags, producing markup with low semantic meaning that is also hard to read and manage. Lastly, the iframe itself is a separate document, so the page has to download and render the iframe document, which requested assets such as JavaScript and CSS. Thus, the iframe initialization is slow and heavy. When we set up an iframe, we need to send messages from the iframe to the host page to communicate events back and forth. For example, if the user resized the window, we need the parent to tell the iframe. This kind of message takes time, and when we are trying to increase front-end performances, eliminating those messages would be a great improvement. What can we do? Let's use a shadow DOM. So, what is a shadow? It's simply a DOM inside another DOM. It has its own isolated DOM tree with elements and styles completely isolated from the original DOM, allowing us to keep the markup structure, style, and behavior hidden and separate from other code on the page so that the different parts don't clash and the code can be kept nice and clean. A shadow DOM, as its name suggested, is always attached to an element within a regular DOM. Without the DOM, a shadow DOM does not exist. The scoped CSS alone is incredibly powerful. The CSS defined inside of the shadow DOM scoped to it, and it has its own style sheets. Style rules don't leak out, and page styles don't bleed in. The scope DOM simplifies the CSS, which means you can use simple CSS selectors, more generic IDs, or class names, and not worry about naming conflict because the shadow DOM is isolated from the rest of the DOM. All the shadow DOM does is to wrap our encapsulate application and therefore the semantic meaning remains the same. For example, if we want a button that allows the user to select a file, the obvious starting point would be a form input. So now we decide we want to use an icon. Instead of the boring choose file button, the shadow DOM allows us to encapsulate an icon under another element, in this case, an input, without changing the functionality or the semantics of that element. Since the shadow DOM is native to the browser, its initialization is much faster than iframe, since it won't require any tools. iframe requires a title, otherwise screen readers announce them simply as iframe. Shadow DOM has no such requirement as it's native to the page. Whenever we look at a cool new browser APIs, we have to also consider support. Luckily, Shadow DOM is supported in all major browsers, except Internet Explorer, which you can use a polyfill to support the Shadow DOM. Shadow DOM is amazing. However, it's not all sunshine and rainbows. We need to consider that the Shadow DOM is not visible to the document query selector and the document query selector all. Therefore, if you would like to start working with Shadow DOM, you will need to rewrite in the code all the use of document query selector and use shadow root instead of the document, which I will explain later what a shadow root is. Even though the Shadow DOM is shielded from the outer style, some styles like color, font, and line heights are still inherited in a Shadow DOM. To ensure a full encapsulation, we will need to use all initial, or preferably all revert, because it has a better browser support. The CSS all property resets all properties to their initial or inherited values. We will apply the all property on the wrapper of the inner Shadow DOM. How the Shadow DOM works behind the scenes. In this diagram, we can see the document tree with the Shadow DOM host attached to it. Shadow host is a regular HTML element within the original DOM that we want to attach the new Shadow DOM to it. Let's take a look at the part where the Shadow DOM is attached to the Shadow host. The place where the Shadow DOM ends and the regular DOM begins is called Shadow Boundary. The Shadow Root is the start of a new Shadow DOM in the way that HTML tag element is the start of the original DOM. The Shadow Root is the root node. Shadow DOM creates a scope DOM tree that is attached to the Shadow host. This scope subtree is called a shadow tree. You can affect the node in the Shadow DOM in the same way as non-shadow nodes, for example, appending children or setting attributes. The difference is that none of the code inside the Shadow DOM can affect anything outside it. How can we create the Shadow DOM? It is a great and powerful tool that can be easily created. Let's take a look at the code. We can attach the shadow root to any element using the attach shadow method. It will create an empty shadow root as a child of our shadow host. The attach shadow method takes as its parameter an option object that contains one option mode with a value of open or closed. Open mode means that you can access the shadow DOM from outside using JavaScript written on the main page. We can do that using the shadow root property of the shadow host element. It will return the shadow root object. Closed mode means that you cannot access the Shadow DOM from outside using JavaScript written on the main page. Thus, the Shadow Root property will return null. After we have attached a Shadow DOM to an element, manipulating is just a matter of using the same DOM APIs as we use for regular DOM manipulation. In this code, for example, we created a div element and appended it to the Shadow Root element, just like we append children in a regular DOM element. Let's take a look at the HTML structure of the Shadow DOM as it appears in the DevTool Inspector. As we can see in the player's HTML structure, the div with the class name Voltax place of the land player is the shadow host. Underneath it, we have the shadow root attached to it with the encapsulate code of the player, which is part of the shadow tree. After we learn so much about Shadow DOM, let's sum it up and see when should we use Shadow DOM. Firstly, as we saw in the player example, standalone application with its own set of functionality hosted on website is a good candidate for Shadow DOM. With this in mind, we should think about what Shadow DOM could solve for us. While both iframes and Shadow DOM provide encapsulation, The Shadow DOM avoids the completely separate context, setup overhead, and clunky markup that occurs with iframes. Twitter used it to change their share this tweet feature. They changed it from iframes to Shadow DOM, primarily for the speed boost. Thank you so much for listening to me. If you have any question, please feel free to reach out.